everybody, and welcome to the Spectrum. Dick Graham again with World Wrestling Federation. An exciting program coming up again from the Spec. And we'd like to make an introduction here to my sidekick this evening, who's no stranger to professional wrestling on television, Gene Okerlund. Gene, welcome to Spectrum tonight.
Well, I thank you very much, Dick Graham. It is a pleasure for me to be ringside at this fantastic World Wrestling Federation card tonight. It's going to be absolutely spectacular, with top international stars from throughout the world as part of this World Wrestling Federation event here at the Spectrum.
Well, we've got an evening of the giants tonight, not solely but partially. Bing Jod Studd will be here, and Bobo Brazil and others, so we'll be getting underway in just a moment. I guess right now we ought to call your attention to the ring and get the announcement for our first matchup.
Wrestling fans, this next contest is a one-fall event with a 20-minute time limit. Introducing first in the corner to my right, hailing from parts unknown, his weight 287 pounds, Moondog Rex. And ladies and gentlemen, from Italy, weighing 238 pounds, Salvatore Bellomo.
Well, Gene, we haven't seen Moondog Rex here at the Spectrum for about a year, maybe a little bit better, but he was in here as part of a tag team, and the fans very well remember him. Of course, he's pitted against tonight against Salvatore Bellomo, who has been here about a year, year and a half now, maybe 2 years, and has quite a nice following. So tonight, anything can happen with Moondog Rex and Salvatore.
Into the ropes, third man in the ring, I should point out, Dick Graham, is referee, former wrestling great, Red Bastien. Heel throw on the part of Moondog Rex, usually teamed up with his partner, colleague, brother, Moondog Spot.
What we have here, probably more than anything, will be the agility and the athletic prowess of Salvatore Bellomo, and a man who's pretty much of a street fighter. We're talking about Moondog Rex. He likes to maul his opponent.
All right, there's a miss on a part of Moondog Rex. I think that is a good comparison, Dick Graham. The beautiful scientific working knowledge of Salvatore Bellomo, and yet the brawling type tactics of Moondog Rex. Collared elbow, Bellomo into a side headlock on the 287-pound Moondog Rex. Quite a weight advantage of nearly 50 pounds. Oh, shoulder! And down goes the Moondog over Bellomo. Oh, good real kick.
We've seen that many times, that particular maneuver by Salvatore Bellomo, and I'll tell you, he loves it, and so does the crowd. Rick's just a little bit confused at this point in time, Gene.
Moondog Rex hailing from parts unknown. I find that easy to believe.
Well, he checked his bones somewhere at ringside on the way in.
Well, that's hung up, actually, on one of the corner ring posts. Right now, Bellomo working on a top wrist lock. Bellomo, of course, immigrating from Italy and Sherry now in the great American dream. Oh, downstairs with a knee, and that doubles up Bellomo. Rex carts him into the top turnbuckle.
Taking it back again.
Well, wait a minute. Block. Oh, Bellomo turns the tables. There's a right to the jaw. Whip into the turnbuckle.
Oh, kick out.
Standing drop kick.
Beautiful.
But almost hot in that ring.
Big guy, man.
Well, we had only a count of two because the Moondog was into the ropes very slightly and for a very brief period of time before they broke. His elbow smashed to the back of the head on Bellomo by Moondog. He's a mauler, as we said, the outset of the match as it began.
Headlock right now, Moondog Rex, and Bellomo tries to counter with a bear hug.
We'll be filling you into the program tonight, but I tell you, it's a dazzler because Bobo Brazil returns to the Spectrum against Big John Studd, Pat Patterson, Greg Valentine, Hulk Hogan, and many others. We'll go to those particular names as we go along tonight. Nice shoulder block. A little wobbly is Belomo. Throw! Flying takedown by Belomo. Kick out, he's outside the ring. Count of two, three, four. Count of five, six.
But I'll tell you, Belomo, wait a minute now, Rex is going to test referee Red Bastien. And that would be the wrong thing to do. Well, in his heyday, Dick Graham, there was nobody any better than Mr. Bastien. They called him the man of a thousand holes.
Well, he was doing his job, Gene, but the Moondog didn't realize that there was a count of five or six going on. If he hadn't distracted Red, he might have been out of it. He might have had the win on the count out. Anyway, he's being warned by the referee to back off. And he doesn't.
Already taking the boots to Belomo, and again, Belomo off the ring apron down on that hard arena floor. And Belomo is going to be truly tested to bring himself back from the punishment that has been handed out thus far this week by Moondog Rex.
Looks like count of six. Belomo pretty much on the way back, maybe.
Being greeted by our right and Moondog Rex. Belomo down. Another pickup. And another shot to the jaw that rocks Salvatore Belomo.
Elbow flailing. Now that very blatant chokehold.
And a referee.
He's standing on the, trying to break it up. There was a tangle of feet there.
Referee admonishing Moondog Rex for the tactics he has been utilizing, especially in light of the fact that he has got Belomo down on that bottom rope, Dick.
Well, they got a break anyway because they're both outside the ring area, if you will, the upper parts of their body outside the rope. For the Moondog, count means nothing if he can count at all.
Well, Moondog Rex. Body shape, devastating tactics. Woo! Oh, what a miss. Nobody home. Salvatore Belomo had checked out when the Moondog arrived.
Well, how often have we seen that, Gene Okerlund? We've seen somebody in the corner, bails out, and just in time, standing drop kick.
Oh! My word. This Belomo showing me a lot. Rex still able to come back. Oh, the mule kick. Standing reverse. Drop kick. Absolutely executed to perfection by Belomo.
Well, I'll tell you, Gene, you wouldn't know there's much of a weight difference between Belomo and Moondog Rex at this point in time. We've seen some shoulder blocks by Belomo.
Look at that series, Dick, of rights to the head. Whoa. Reversal into the ropes. Up that over. Oh, power slam. One, two. Wait a minute. Wait a minute. Certainly, Moondog Rex could have pinned Belomo. I would like to think that he could have got him for the pin, but he chose not to do so.
He wants to punish him, Gene. Same maneuver again.
Oh,
whoa!
Ball package, takedown, hooks the leg.
Hey! Nailed him.
Oh, my.
And the Moondog is upset.
Well, there's your winner, Salvatore Belomo. Here's something else. What a win. I'm certain you concur with me on that, Dick Graham.
Let's get the
official time from the ring announcer.
All right, here's Mel Phillips.
Ladies and gentlemen, the winner of this contest, Salvatore Belomo.
Well, this crowd certainly... Wait a minute.
It's not over yet.
With his fans, Moondog Rex going over, getting that animal bone.
Well, it's all over. I thought they were going to go back for a second portion, a second helping of the match. All right, let's pick up the action here, as it was just before the pin.
Into the ropes. Here is the potential power slam, but take a look at Salvatore Belomo. Wraps Moondog Rex up into a small package. One, two, three, and he gets the subsequent pinfall. Good win for Belomo.
Dick Graham here with Gene Okerlund, and we'll be back with more wrestling excitement after this.
Thank you, Dick Graham. I'm back here with Bobo Brazil, the veteran. He is facing Big John Studd, the giant. How do you feel about facing off against a man this size?
Well, listen, Cal, you just said Big John Studd. He is a bad, bad super dude, and he's a big dude. But you know, that's the way I like him.
Oh, yeah?
Cal, you know, I've been away from here for a long, long time. And now I'm here to please my fans again. I don't want no small guys. I want all these big giants they have around here that's supposed to be super bad.
Uh-huh.
You know, the funny thing, I just overheard a conversation with Big John Studd talking to Dickie Murdoch. Dickie Murdoch said, listen, Studd said, let me tell you something. He said, Bobo Brazil, he may give you a little trouble.
Uh-huh.
Let me tell you something, Studd. I am double trouble. When you get into the ring with me, you're going to have your hands full. I have seen you in action many times. With your big 6'9" body, you just clobber your opponents all over the ring. The referee wants to have mercy on those guys, but you just keep beating them. Just keep pounding on them. Let me tell you one thing, Stud. Brazil is here, and I'm here to stay. I'm not going no place. I'm looking for all you big bad dudes. You big bad dudes, you big globetrotters. You go all over the country talking about how big and bad you are. Because Brazil's been away, but I want to tell you one thing. Brazil's been wrestling. I get my wrestling in. I get my gym work in. I know you guys pushes those weights. You're tough. That's all I can say about you, Big John Studd. I know you're tough. I know I have a lot of trouble when I get into the ring with you. But you won't beat me to pull the poles like I think you do many of your opponents. I promise you that.
Now, they say the bigger they are,
the harder they fall.
Uh-huh.
And you know one thing, Cal, but I'm not too small myself.
No, you're pretty big size.
Big
man.
John Studd, he'll never push me all over the ring. Because when I had those fans out there, they'd be cheering me on and say, Brazil, go, Brazil, go. And that makes me feel good. That give me the power to go and beat you, Big John Studd. I promise all my fans I'd do just that.
Well, I know one thing from what you said. Bobo Brazil, you're serious as a heart attack. We'll be right back.
As Dick Graham ringside at the Spectrum and Gene Okerlund with us, and now to Mel Phillips and the announcer.
Wrestling fans, the following attraction is a one-fall event with a 20-minute time limit. Introducing first, from Los Angeles, California, his weight, 364 pounds.
7 foot plus, nearly 400 pounds, the new John Studd.
Ladies and gentlemen.
The giant Studd.
Big John Studd. And ladies and gentlemen, from Benton Arbor, Michigan, his weight, 287 pounds, the legendary Bobo Brazil.
All right. Bobo Brazil this week setting his sights on the likes of Big John Studd, one fall matchup. Third man of the ring is referee Joe Morella. Like to have your candid opinion, and speculate, if you will, Dick Graham, on the outcome of this one.
I don't know that I would bet on it if I had the money to bet, Gene, because you just have two giants in the ring. It's a battle of strength. Each man has been in the wrestling profession for a number of years, so they know all the angles, they know all the holds.
Oh, beautiful block and a part of Brazil. Certainly threatening Studd at the outside of this bout. Studd hanging onto those ropes for dear life, a couple of big forearms to the upper back and a shot downstairs. And now Stud starts to assert himself. Bobo Brazil, perhaps one of the greatest black wrestlers of all time.
No doubt about that, Gene. And he's here wrestling against Big John Stud, and he's handing Stud's head to him, so to speak. Take him into the corner. An elbow smash.
Oh, my. And Stud counters with an elbow that rocks Bobo Brazil. Into the ropes. Off he comes.
Oh, shoulder block.
Well, partial shoulder, I believe, a little elbow got in there, too. Stud seems to get bigger and better every time I see him, Dick Graham.
Well, he hasn't been here about a year, but I tell you, Brazil and John Stud are very well matched. Doing the bear hug thing on Brazil right now. Look at the agony in the face.
Well, you can just see it on the visage of Bobo Brazil. He is experiencing a great deal of pain. Referee checking to see if perhaps Brazil may be out of it. Brazil threatening. But all of a sudden, Stud tightens the screws just a little bit more.
Well, he's wearing tree trunks for arms. No doubt about that. A great deal of strength with both these men. If you look at the faces as our camera picks them up. Agony, intensity, concentration. Right now, it's kind of a Mexican standoff, although I would say John Stud is in the driver's seat with a bear hug around the likes of Bobo Brazil.
Brazil, a veteran of 287 pounds, native of Benton Harbor, Michigan. Big John Stud, considerably more size, but look at this.
Now we have the reversal, and Brazil with the bear hug.
Uh-oh. Tables turned. Only momentarily, as first Stud raking the eyes of Brazil, and Brazil comes right back with a little of the same medicine for Big John Stud.
Well, the headbutt. Oh, Rokobot.
Oh, that had to do some powerful damage.
Stud wants out, buying a little bit of time here, Gene. Fans not liking it.
And I don't blame him, because that Rokobot is a patented move on the part of Bobo Brazil, and these fans are on their feet.
Well, Brazil's boosting down to the floor. The Stud to come off, back up. Come on, I got more for you. Stud making a move toward the ring, but nevertheless not totally getting into it.
Well, Big John Stud, undoubtedly one of the most extraordinary men to ever don a pair of tights and enter the ring. One of the premier wrestlers in the World Wrestling Federation today. There's a big forearm. I don't know how much that, well, there it did a little damage because it rocked Brazil into the ropes, and now Stud is openly and blatantly, flagrantly choking Brazil.
Well, Stud has a tendency to reject any admonishing by the referee to cool it down. All he knows is fall, beat, pulverize. That's his style. One, two.
Two count only.
John Roller right on the scene there, too. Very quickly on the scene.
I don't know where Bobo Brazil gets it, but tremendously resilient after the pounding he had taken at the hands of Big John Stud. Stud with a face lock now on Brazil.
Well, Morell is only concerned right now there might be any kind of a choking off of the air supply, but satisfied there isn't. Still, John Stud maintains that tremendous pressure on the chin, the neck area, on Bobo Brazil.
Tremendous crowd on hand this week for this one fall World Wrestling Federation event between Big John Stud and Bobo Brazil.
Going with a side headlock, take him into the ropes. Oh, look at that. Talk about a standoff. Shoulder blocks mean nothing. Two immovable objects. Woo, with a headbutt. Brazil with a tremendous headbutt.
Oh,
John Stud.
Indeed. Oh, downstairs with a knee. Very low on Brazil.
All right, Brazil. Opening up here. And,
oh, wow.
11 at the zone for crowd.
Now Brazil threatening. Watch it. Oh, Rokobot. And Stud, all 6'10", timber.
Just like a tree falling, and the same way did Bobo Brazil fall. Elbow smash. Two.
aggressive on the part of Big John Studd, the man you see getting the nuke in his one fall bout over Bobo Brazil. It happened so quickly, I think Brazil is still trying to gather himself. Dick, I don't think he realized it had been had taken place.
Well, Gene, it happened so fast, I don't think he's still sort of shocked.
All right, let's get the official decision.
Ladies and gentlemen, the winner of this contest, Big John Studd.
The Giant Studd!
Let's take a look at the replay, Dick Graham, in slow motion, and see how this man, Big John Studd, put his opponent away, Bobo Brazil.
Well, there's the headbutt. Down goes Studd.
And now, all of a sudden, Brazil off the ropes, trying for a leg drop, but Studd alertly moves out, follows up with a flying elbow in his own. The Bobo Brazil, 1-2-3, and summarily, Studd gets the pin count and continues his winning ways in the World Wrestling Federation.
You're watching Spectrum Wrestling exclusively on Prism, and we'll be right back.
Valentine, out of the ring and out of the arena floor. We may see battle before this thing is all over with out on the arena floor this week.
Well, Patterson's right after him, and Valentine on a tear, and right after him.
Oh, there's a boot. Patterson under the bottom rope, and he was greeted with a big boot on the part of Valentine. An elbow and a forearm.
Well, Valentine, I think, faked out Patterson.
Oh, what a forearm to the chops.
Coming on him again, right on the forehead again with the elbow. Valentine, I think, got to Patterson, believing that he was on a tear running away from him, but then got him in the ring at his advantage. And he took it to him as he is right now.
All right, headlock of Pat Patterson, third man of the ring, referee all over that situation, checking very carefully to make certain that Mr. Valentine does not slip the forearm underneath the chin and probably cut the throat of the windpipe off. Beautiful pickup on a part, I'll tell you.
I was going to body slam him in the ring around. Oh!
Right across that top rope in the throat that time, and from our vantage point, Dick Graham, it was quite obvious.
Well, Patterson took it right on the Adam's apple, impairing the breathing, and of course, Valentine knew exactly what he was doing, but right, we have a count going on by the referee.
Oh, my!
Patterson's
look at that.
Down on the floor.
Pat Patterson taking an elbow as he was draped over the top rope. He just catapulted off the ring apron down out of this hard cement floor at this beautiful facility.
Well, Valentine looking now, he talked away from by the referee. He was about ready to go on down to the floor here outside the ring to come on down on Patterson to decide against it. Of course, Valentine from a very illustrious wrestling family. He's not very well liked here, but you got to admit, the man knows what he's doing. Patterson favoring a leg as he walks, limps more like it, around the side of the ring.
Well, the count continues by referee Dick Worley. Patterson on the ring apron, but all of a sudden a very aggressive Greg Valentine gets in there. The referee has to start the count all over again. Patterson is back, and a snapmare takedown. All right.
Here comes. Woo! He wound up and cranked up on that one. Patterson saw it coming.
Oh, look at Patterson come back.
He's coming back for real.
Coming to right, one of the midsection, that one of the jaw, and that rocks. Greg the Hammer Valentine. Patterson with a boot. And Patterson is hot. Oh, my word. Look at this.
Valentine. Woo!
Oh! Oh! Come on. A big guy threatening with an atomic drop. Oh, my. Look at that.
But the crowd is loving it. And are they ever. They'll make a boy soprano out of Valentine.
He may be singing with the Bee Gees next week. Oh! Sidebreaker! Whoa, just at the very last second, getting that leg out of the rope.
As you can see on your screen, to the right of your screen, the leg draped over the bottom rope, and that breaks up the count, but doesn't break up the momentum that Patterson has developed.
Pat Patterson is on a roll, and obviously, this capacity, crowd loves it. Oh, look at this. Double leg takedown. Patterson tried to roll Valentine over. The potential here for a Boston Crab, Dick Graham.
Valentine grabbing for the bottom rope because he wants no part of this particular maneuver by Pat Patterson. Outside the ring he goes to buy a little time. Patterson very much in control right now. He's waiting in there. Still being counted on, counted down, is Greg Valentine. It's like,
watch this. Watch this, Dick. Beautiful.
Body slam.
Body slam. He took him over the ropes.
You talk about these guys being strong and in shape. You just saw a great example of it.
Right now, Patterson. Woo! With a pickup.
Patterson really doing his number on Greg Valentine now. And the fans are eating it up.
Patterson really asserting himself, but again, I believe, putting himself in position. Oh!
Woo!
What a move and a part of the great Pat Patterson.
Well, Valentine barely hanging on to the ropes and then suddenly collapsed. And like a cat, Patterson right back on him again. Body slam city. Patterson going for the kill.
Just the very last second, Patterson couldn't have been more than 3 or 4 feet away from the upper torso of Greg the Hammer Valentine. But Patterson comes up empty-handed.
Well, you know,
watch out. Hold on. Dick, here it comes. Figure four.
Figure four.
That could be it.
It may be all over. I don't know.
How much pain can he take?
Dick Worley knows this hold could put Patterson away.
Oh. Patterson cannot get to Valentine. Well, finally, he got to the hair. The pain has got to be excruciating. That's it.
That's
it. It's all over.
But still, Valentine maintains the pressure.
Come on, Valentine. Give us a break.
I think that's what he's liking to do to Patterson. Give him a break.
All right. That man right there getting the Duke. Via submission over this man, Pat Patterson, in World Wrestling Federation action, as Greg the Hammer Valentine continues his winning way.
Your winner by a submission, Greg the Hammer Valentine.
Well, Dick Graham, I think you're going to concur with me. That figure four, wait a minute, let's not go away. There's still action. Oh, Valentine has pushed the referee.
He's back on the figure four again.
Back to the figure four. And again, Pat Patterson has got to withstand that pain. And look at the movement of Valentine.
I don't know how he can take
it. Oh, my word.
Valentine was trying to cripple him.
Now he's gone berserk. The wheels have gone off, Dick.
Nobody home. And I'll tell you, he literally, it seemed to me, he tried to cripple Pat Patterson. Well, the fans are letting him know where he stands for them. Woo!
Come on. Greg Valentine.
All right, let's check it out. We're going to watch it all over again in slow motion. There he is maintaining that figure four leg lock pressure. Pat Patterson, he finally can't take it. And I don't know a man in the world can take that particular hold. And Patterson got back in it again with Valentine after the count out, after the submission. Whew. Well, coming up next on Prism, it's the Eye of the Tiger as the Hulker. Hulk Hogan battles with Mr. Wonderful, Paul Orndorff, in the main event for the World Championship. You're watching Spectrum Wrestling exclusively on Prism. Dick Graham back here at ringside, and Cal Rudman is in the interview area. So take it away, Cal.
Thank you, Dick Graham. And who do you suppose is sashaying in here? Bad to the bone.
Killer Cal, my main man. You know, I got the guns up in the air, and I wanted to warn you. I wanted to warn all of Philadelphia. It wasn't a 747 coming in for a crash landing, Daddy. It was just the 24-inch pythons, the largest arms in the world, Daddy. Check them out, Killer Cal. Bigger than your head, bigger than your everybody's head. But that's the thing. That's what it's all about. I train, I say my prayers, eat my vitamins. And I'm on an all-natural high, man, because I just rode by the front of the spectrum. See my main man, Sly Sloan, standing in front with his arms raised in victory. And then I pulled around the side. And when I parked my Lincoln Continental, there was a riot going on, man. I mean, there was a party. All my people were out in the parking lot. They were drinking beer. They were training in the parking lot. And Hulkamania was running wild. That's why I'm so psyched up. That's why I'm ready for Paula. And you know, Cal, I kind of pity the dude. The way he swishes around the ring. The way he throws his shoulders back and looks down on everybody. And I pity the dude because tonight, the Hulkster gets to wrap his paws around his neck.
Well, I was watching Paul Orndorff on the TV, and he had some very interesting things to say about you. He said that you're a movie wrestler. You're not in real life. You know, he was fullback for the New Orleans Saints for 5 years, and he's got a tremendous physique. He said that all you can do is pick up the aforementioned Sly Stallone, but when it comes to him, that's something else. You want to comment on that?
Well, you know, Killer Cal, talk is cheap, man. We can talk all night long. Matter of fact, me and Paula, we've been talking about each other for quite some time. But the thing is, you're halfway right, Paula, but only halfway. I did have a permanent address on Hollywood and Vine. Took my main man, Sly, pressed him over my head, and sent him into orbit. Turned everybody on. Box office attraction. But now you got to realize, don't laugh until I tell you. Now you got to realize, man, I'm the WWF, the World's Heavyweight Champion, the real champion from Madison Square Garden. This is for real, Daddy, and this is the bone that all the dogs want. But the thing is, I'm the big dog in the junkyard right now, the baddest dog there is, and with the 24-inch pythons, I'm going to keep chewing on this bone. So, doggy, bow, wow, 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 go! Come get the bone, Orndorff, if you got enough guts. Step in the center of the ring with a Hulkster, man. Come try to take the bone away from the junkyard dog. But the thing is, Killer Cal, have you ever fell in love with a woman, man, so bad it made you shake, rattle, and roll, and you drop to your knees? Did you ever fall in love like that?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, I know you did. Did you lose it? I bet you lost it, though. But that's the thing. You lost it. I knew you did. That's the same thing that happened in Madison Square Garden when I won the WWF title. It was something that took me over like an earthquake. I fell in love with a WWF. I fell in love with a world title, and it's a feeling that I'm not going to lose, Daddy. I'm not going to lose it because I want to keep it, man. I like being number one. I like being on top, and I like the fact that everybody out there in the spectrum is behind me. It kind of drives me wild, man. I feel the energy, the Hulkamania, the psyche, the electricity, and it just pumps me up because I drain all the power from my people, and then I use it on my opponents. And tonight, Paula, what you going to do when the Hulkster and Hulkamania is running wild on you?
Well, you heard the Hulkster answer the words of Paul Orndorff. Now you're going to see him answer him in the ring. We'll be right back.
Well, the place is coming apart at the seams because we're getting ready for another happening.
Look at the graffiti ringside.
Woo-hoo! You've got such things as...
Hold on.
The Eye of the Tiger.
And that can mean only one thing. The arrival of the World Wrestling Federation's heavyweight champion as Survivor hangs it out. Here he comes. Oh, this place is going to explode.
It's building.
Is unglued. Oh, get nuts. Go crazy.
Hulkamania has set in. Orndorff. If Hulk Hogan hasn't psyched Orndorff out of his mind by now, I don't know what can. Listen to the crowd.
Get the preliminaries, at least the introductions, out of the way here, Dick.
Wrestling Federation Heavyweight Championship. Introducing first the challenger from Tampa, Florida, weighing 257 pounds, Mr. Wonderful, Paul Orndorff. Ladies and gentlemen, from Venice Beach, California, tipping the scale at 303 pounds, the current World Wrestling Federation Heavyweight Champion, the incredible Hulk Hogan!
Well, Dick, a world title on the line this week. It is one fall, 1 hour bout for the heavyweight championship, and Orndorff has got to come to Hogan.
Indeed he does, Gene. And I'll tell you, as they say in sports, if the crowd ever has any bearing on the outcome, this should be a foregone conclusion. And it's underway!
Oh! Katie by the door!
Woo-hoo!
Atomic drop! Oh, and a right that rocks Orndorff!
Hasn't even allowed Orndorff to get out of his robe.
Oh, look at this. Changing blows, breaks the eyes. Headbutt, Orndorff down. At Hogan. Oh-hoo!
Woo-hoo!
Now Hogan.
He is at...
Oh, no! Look at this.
Back in the ring.
Woo-hoo!
Orndorff.
Oh no, the bell has been thrown in. Orndorff, are you kidding me?
No way. The Hulk is a hand throwing himself, but now the bell. Threatening Orndorff, look out. Orndorff hasn't even been in the ball game yet. It's been Hulk Hogan all the way thus far. Hogan should not, though, relax, Gene.
Well, this facility has absolutely erupted, and I'm afraid it's going to explode pretty quick. You see the graffiti in the hands of Hulk Hogan. Paula. And needless to say, that gets to this man.
I gotta give Orndorff some credit, though, with obviously everybody in this arena against him. He's hanging in. And even the way this got underway with Hogan, very much the aggressor, as a champion should. I don't know, the man, I gotta give him some measure of credit. Well, the rope's off. They're ready to go. Let's see what happens. Mr. Wonderful against the Incredible Hulk.
Well, these fans have waited a long time for this one. Side headlock. Hogan to Orndorff. Of course, you've got to realize Dick Graham, Paul Orndorff wouldn't be here if somebody didn't think he was a pretty fair country wrestler.
Oh, that's for sure, Gene. He is that. But he's messing with a heck of a man with the Hulker.
Hulk Hogan arm wide open now says, come on.
Woo-hoo!
Kiss my...
That gesture said it all.
I got it.
And so did everybody else. I don't know how much more you can do to taunt a man than the taunting Hogan's already doing and has done so far to Mr. Wonderful, Paul Orndorff. You'll get no sympathy for referee, I'm sure.
Now listen to this.
Well, I'll tell you, the music played when Hogan came out, the Eye of the Tiger, is nothing compared to what Orndorff has experienced now. He's in the eye of the hurricane, I think.
What a shot of the heavyweight champion of the world, a 302-pounder, 6'8", a native of Venice Beach, California. And what a popular champion he is. The Incredible Hulk Hogan right now. Orndorff starting to move in. Inviting a Greco-Roman lock up. Oh, he tried with a left, but he didn't connect, Dick.
Well, there's some threat of the fist, the punch, but it hasn't materialized as yet. He's warned off as young Morella, the referee, making contact, maybe. Battle of strength.
Oh!
Oh! Hogan has a million tricks up his sleeve.
And I've got to believe his reach is just a little more extended, a little longer than Paul Orndorff's.
Well, Orndorff was concentrating on the contact of the hands upcoming and wasn't ready for the slap of the face.
Now, that was just a good old country right that absolutely devastated Paul Orndorff. And again, the multitudes on hand this week for this World Wrestling Federation championship match.
Orndorff, I think, went for the eyes on the champion.
He did. He's following up with a series of boots to the ribcage of the Incredible Hulk Hogan. Hogan out on the arena floor. Orndorff following.
Well, it must be payback time.
Oh, come on, no.
Oh, he took him right into the wrought iron railing.
Oh, no, no. There's a chair.
Well, Orndorff is not Mr. Wonderful for nothing. He revels in the fact that he's not actually Mr. Wonderful. Hogan can attest to that right now. And there's blood on the head of Hogan.
I'm concerned. I'm deeply concerned. Hulk Hogan really took a devastating shot with that chair at the hands of Paul Orndorff.
Well, the back of the head is bloodied on Hulk Hogan right now. I presume.
No. Oh, no.
Blood coming down the face of Hulk Hogan. He is damaged goods right now.
You know, he may be hurt to the point, Dick Graham, where Hulk Hogan may be unable to mount any kind of an offensive or even hold his own. And it's conceivable we may see a new world's heavyweight champion in Paul Orndorff.
Well, I was blocked by the body of Orndorff, but the referee just counted to three. I don't know whether Orndorff was fighting.
Oh, no.
I don't know, but there's more blood.
No.
All the time.
Hogan is bleeding profusely. He is hemorrhaging very badly.
Oh, ho, ho!
Woo! Wait a minute.
Hogan! It's... Oh! It's payback time!
What an offensive. What a spurt. Orndorff is out of it. Hogan still bleeding, however.
Oh, he's fighting it back. He's returning the favor Orndorff extended to him, biting his face earlier. High payback time.
Oh, look at that right. Both bend out of their knees. Ladies and gentlemen, you are seeing two of the very best in the entire world. Title bout, everything.
Oh! All 300 pounds of Hogan pounding into the ring corner.
He has raked the front part of the body of Paul Orndorff with his fingernails.
Oh!
Orndorff goes downstairs. Hogan counters by raking the eyes. Oh, the devastating right to the head.
And there, Hogan fighting on him again. I don't know. I don't know what more we can see in the way of mauling someone or pounding. Side headlock, smash in the face. And I'll tell you, if it weren't for the body of Hogan, Orndorff would be down, I think, or he's almost.
And the ropes, here's the whip.
Not over yet.
Timber!
Hit him with a size 13 shoe.
Well, that boot perfectly placed as Orndorff came off the ropes. And watch this. A series of blows to the side of the head of Paul Orndorff by the heavyweight champion of the world.
Well, the referee warning about the closed fist on Hogan against Orndorff. Don't go that well too often.
Clothesline. Orndorff somehow comes back and tumbles the champion.
Well, he came off the ring corner off the ropes, and a little bit of momentum going. The clothesline that you said, Gene, the world champion, and Hogan is down and very much bloodied right now and stunned.
Oh, slam into the canvas. Paul Orndorff continues to come back, and now Orndorff is asserting himself. You notice how he maneuvered that elbow pad down off the hand, and that's what hit him. A raw elbow just nailed the incredible Hulk Hogan.
We're seeing the traditional Paul Orndorff now exulting. He's exulting into the demise, he says or thinks, of Hulk Hogan. But it's not over. Oh, the laces on the boot right across the eyes of Hulk Hogan. Orndorff is on a tear.
Referee Joey Morella's got his hands more than full this week at his title bout. I should point out, Hogan is still hemorrhaging very badly as a result of that tear in Paul Orndorff earlier on in this match.
Well, he's taking more of a pounding by Orndorff, who is really on a tear. Looks to be 1-2. Hogan got some energy somewhere and kicked out of that, close to a pin. But not quite.
Orndorff, however, should be pointed out, relentless. He is not letting up, capitalizing on every opportunity. He's not going to give Hogan a break.
Well, what started out as a match favoring Hogan, the way it started, Orndorff in control right now.
Hold on!
Hogan,
wait a minute!
Shot.
Look at him hulk up! Oh, block! And now Hogan counters right. Followed by a left. Oh, my word.
I don't believe it.
A 360.
He really was a 360.
I'd like to knock him into next week.
And an elbow. Not a clothesline, but an elbow all the way on Orndorff.
Oh, my. Look at Hogan take charge.
Oh, Orndorff. Bend over, reached over, raked his nails, look to be across the eyes of Hogan, and down he goes again. The champion hanging on by a thread. Orndorff not in good shape himself, I don't think, but nevertheless, he is in control, it seems. And a body slam or a backbreaker. Woo! You talk about somebody in shape, Gene Oberlin. It is amazing the pounding that Orndorff has taken to the back now. Orndorff going up for the 747s. Going into the stratosphere. Woo! And alive, the Hulkamania has set in again.
Clothesline, fought on by a flying leg drop.
One,
hooks the leg, two, three.
All over. All over.
Getting the Duke. Woo! Still heavyweight champion of the world. This crowd erupts,
and they're all standing, Gene. They are standing. Oh. Well, the battle's on again. Oh! Morella taking a shot from Orndorff. Hogan in the corner with it. Oh, Orndorff splitting the scene.
This fan.
Well, the fans obviously do. Listen to the crowd. Listen to the cheering. It's insanity. All of the hope. Woo! Hogan slapping hands of the fans as he goes out. They're loving it.
I'll tell you what. Let's get the official decision. I want to see the replay also on that.
Ladies and gentlemen, the winner of this contest, and still World Wrestling Federation Heavyweight Champion, the Incredible Hulk Hogan.
Winner and still a heavyweight champion of the world. Let's go back and see in slow motion.
Just
Hulk Hogan, clotheslines. Orndorff follows it up with a flying leg drop right across the upper torso. Goes for the pin. A stupid hooks the leg. Summerly gets the 1-2-3 pin count. Some kind of action.
Cal Rudman will be along shortly with some special musical guests, so stay tuned. We'll check in with Cal after this. All right, Dick Graham here, ringside. And Gene Okerlund, we have a tremendous card and just about ready to get underway our next event. And the Samoans are on the scene. Very unpredictable.
Well, indeed they are in the ring at this time. Mr. Fuji, Tiger Chung Lee, and here they come. In the foreground is Sika. In the background, Afa.
Here they
are. Three-time co-holders of the World Wrestling Federation Tag Team Championships on their way.
Well, Mr. Fuji and Tiger Chung Lee awaiting the arrival of the Samoans. You just saw them coming back down the chute from the dressing room area, and Bedlam will probably take place any moment now. Take your pick. I don't know that either tag team is particularly a favorite here. Afa and Sika, the Samoans.
My.
They get their messages from somewhere in outer space, I believe.
Sika, while Samoans 1 and 2 right now making their way up onto the ring apron through the ropes, and there Dick Graham is a lot of beef. Where's the beef? There's the beef.
And Bell Phillips is right in between it all with Dick Worley, so let's find out who is who.
All right, let's get the introduction.
Ladies and gentlemen, this next contest is indeed a battle of the Roughnecks. It is a special tag team attraction scheduled for one fall with a 45-minute time limit. Introducing first in the corner to my right, the tag team combination that consists of first from Osaka, Japan, weighing 247 pounds, the samurai warrior, Mr. Fuji. And his tag team partner from Seoul, Korea, weighing 271 pounds, Tiger Chung Lee. Ladies and gentlemen, their opposition this evening hail from the Isles of Samoa, having a total combined weight of 596 pounds, Afa Sika, the Wild Samoans.
Well, there you have it, fans, the introduction, and whatever, I hesitate to say what could happen, because nobody knows with the Samoans when they're involved what probably will take place, but you know it's going to be Bedlam for sure. Dick Worley is the fifth man in the squared circle right now, and just to mention Dick Worley's baseball teams here tonight, the Deptford Junior Travelers, they've got 16-0 over in the Jersey Tri-County League. They're doing very, very well, so they're in evidence tonight, so Dick run his own band club with them. Okay, I don't know who's going to kick this off, whether it be Tiger Chung Lee or Mr. Fuji.
All right, you see the team right there of Tiger Chung Lee in the foreground and Mr. Fuji in the background. The Oriental Express, the traditional Japanese ceremony of throwing the salt up over the top turnbuckle to supposedly drive the evil spirits away. Some ceremonial goings on between Fuji and Tiger Chung Lee. And this week of the World Wrestling Federation, the Oriental. Well, there's a little ceremony, too, from a wild Samoan.
I don't know that we've actually seen that kind of an approach before, that ceremony, as you put it, but they may be not to be outdone by the Mr. Fuji and by Tiger Chung Lee.
All right, we are set for action. The bell has sounded. It's going to be Fuji and Big Apa kicking off this tag team bout. I expect a real wild brawl.
A couple of words going between the two brothers, the Samoans. Everything's okay now, I presume. Going for the eyes, as Mr. Fuji seems to be, breaking the tape wrist, but not for long. Nice chop across the Adam's apple down Mr. Fuji. And a headbutt to boot. You know what the commotion is? Well, there's something in the foreign subject in the right hand or fist. Well, Fuji warily checking him out.
He's a master. As hiding things, he did so beautifully there.
Well, the fans are pointing, and apparently Whirly seems satisfied with what's going on.
From our vantage point, I saw it too. I'm not so certain he might not have had that salt or perhaps some other foreign object. There's an exchange, and quite obvious. Well, for those of you watching at home, there you can see it, plain as day. Our foreign object that we alluded to earlier, Dave.
Okay, alert cameraman at ringside picking up the foreign object. And still Whirly checking out Mr. Fuji. He'll find nothing as we know, but Whirly has not seen what we have seen. There we are, back into the game.
Well, there's the exchange.
Talk about sly.
And now the referee is checking over Tiger Chung Lee. And again the exchange.
Fuji taunted the Samoans with that foreign object and then handed it off again. I think he has it back in his tights. I'm not sure. Anyway, Whirly has his hands full and then some at this point in time. Fans are getting a little nervous. Not much activity right here.
Still Mr. Fuji and Sika, Samoan number one, Big Sika, Apa, talking to the referee. If he's speaking in his native tongue, the referee's got absolutely no chance.
Well, still things are out. They finally make contact.
Oh, look at Sika take charge as he asserts himself with a series of lefts. Oh, and a reverse knife edge for the right.
A tag, and out comes Tiger Chung Lee. Out goes Fuji, or shortly.
Well, he's going to have to get out of there. Tiger Chung Lee, 271 pounds, Seoul, Korea. An absolute master of the martial arts, very much.
Well, now Whirly checking out the wrestling garb, if you will, of Tiger Chung Lee. Finds nothing and indicates such to the Samoans. There's nothing there. It's okay. Chung Lee is indicating a man's not wrapped too tight. He's seeing something that is not there. Maybe. Whoa! Looks like the Samoan a little upset about the gesture by Tiger Chung Lee. Take him into the ropes. Ducks under it. Oh, ducks under two of the chops. Oh, love it, love it, love it. And the fan 2-2. The Samoan took it right to him after exchange little double takes there by Tiger Chung Lee. Now it's complaint time, huh? Dick Whirly saying, come on, let's get it on. Lee getting a bit of advice from Mr. Fuji over on the other side of the ring. And the same holding true here on this side with the Samoans. I think the fans are saying, what's the talk? Let's get it together here. Let's get it on. And they finally do. Going for the wrist. Apply a little pressure there. Nothing out of the ordinary. Payne going right up to the shoulder on Tiger Chung Lee. Oh, headbutt. Famous maneuver by the Samoans. They love the headbutt. Interesting to watch this setup because I don't know what maneuvers the Samoans have leading up to. Oh. Tried to reverse this on the Samoan. He said, something's wrong here. He's at the short end of this right now. So we're doing psych jobs, Gene.
All right. Big Apa playing games thus far with Tiger Chung Lee. He has had the man totally confused. Now these two men eye each other and proceed. Sika out of the ring apron, waiting anxiously for an opportunity to get into the thick of the battle. A leg takedown on the part of Samoa number one. Oh, my word.
Brought all that weight down on the knee.
What an impressive body splash. Here's a little teamwork, and again, this time, Sika gets to the inner left leg of Tiger Chung Lee, the veteran from Korea. Mr. Fuji threatens. And there you see the pain that Tiger Chung Lee obviously is going through at the hands of Sika, one of the two wild Samoans. Again, I want to point out three-time former tag team champions here in the World Wrestling Federation this week. Wild Samoans doing battle with the Oriental Express of Tiger Chung Lee and Mr. Fuji.
We're still applying that pressure, and Dick Worley, the referee, just momentarily distracted by Mr. Fuji while the pain still being applied to Tiger Chung Lee by Apa, or Sika now.
Well, now all of a sudden, I believe, I've got to suspect perhaps a rake of the eyes of the part of Tiger Chung Lee goes to the hair. There is one of those martial arts moves having a little or no effect, though, on Big Sika. While Samoans pretty close in weight and height, collectively 596, and there is a headbutt that has backfired on the likes of Tiger Chung Lee. It is Lee who is wilted to his knees. Now watch out. Oh, hold up, boom! Oh, what a headbutt on a part of Sika that absolutely rocks Tiger Chung Lee.
Well, the tag not made. Fuji expecting a tag.
I don't know. Apparently,
the tag made.
Fuji a little reluctant there at first, but has second thoughts, takes the tag from Tiger Chung Lee, and now Mr. Fuji to try his best on Wild Samoa number two, Sika.
Well, they're stalking each other right now, making contact.
Fuji moves down on the arm to the wrist with a turnover. Sika, as you can see, trying to keep that left arm as loose as possible, not to lose circulation. Oh, headbutt to the shoulder. And you should have seen the expression on Fuji down on the canvas. Oh, my. Trying for a pin. 1-2. And I'll take a look at this. Yet another expression on the visage of Mr. Fuji. Gene Okerlund along with Dick Graham. This week, tag team action between the Wild Samoans and a combo, the tandem of Tiger Chung Lee and a man who's on the receiving end of a little punishment from the Wild Samoans, Mr. Fuji.
Well, Sika applying the pressure and maintaining it, and Fuji on the short end and in trouble right now. And looking for help from somewhere, but he's not about to get it. He's too far away from the other corner where his tag team partner, Tiger Chung Lee, is. So he's one-on-one with Sika at the present time.
Now Tiger Chung Lee giving it a thought, but he is quickly discouraged by referee Dick Worley reprimanding Lee, saying, don't even try it.
Well, it looks to me Sika's trying to move along with Fuji to make the tag, and there it is. So we have the Samoans exchanging positions right now.
Oh, what a left to the top of the dome of Mr. Fuji on a part of Apa. Samoa number one.
And Offa says, hey, I might as well pick up the same hold that brother Sika had a moment ago because it's working. And he has him pretty much in the middle of the ring away from Tiger Chung Lee. So no tag didn't happen right now.
All right, a packed house, I'll tell you. Capacity crowd on hand, I believe. The crowd favorites kind of swinging for the Wild Samoans, Offa and Sika.
Well, Fuji going for the upper body now. Down goes Offa.
Well, obviously,
oh, mercy,
watch
mercy.
It now. Woo! By a bonsai! Downstairs with a headbutt.
Hit him right in the manhood, and Sika coming in, not liking the turn of events, and now here's Tiger Chung Lee.
Wait a minute, come on, ref, give me a break, turn around and get in a game.
Well, the tag made, kind of. Worley didn't see it one way or the other. He was admonishing the Samoan at the time. Sika was outside the ring.
The communication between Offa and Sika is just fantastic. However, there they had no chance with the double teaming of the part of Mr. Fuji and Tiger Chung Lee. Offa taking a little punishment there. Mr. Fuji working on the trapezius muscles, perhaps slipping that up along the neck and working on a nerve on the side of the neck. He may be even going for the carotid artery.
He might have that, or just to put the arm asleep. I don't know whether he has that
well,
in mind.
And on Offa has faded completely because he just went right down.
He's moving ever just so slightly. Count of two, and he's shoulder him up. So from somewhere inside himself, he just knew instinctively to raise one shoulder.
A little double teaming on the part of Offa Sika. There was a change while the referee's back was turned between Mr. Fuji and Tiger Chung Lee. And if you're confused, ladies and gentlemen, so are we.
This For sure.
week, tag team action. This has kind of been a seesaw battle thus far, but I expect the explosion to take place here. One of these two teams is going to tire, and we're going to see somebody dominate, I would think.
Well, it seems to be, Gene, right now that the Samoans are on the short end as far as tiring is concerned. Could be because Tiger Chung Lee still maintaining pressure on Offa, who's trying to get to his feet, and the crowd, then usually against the Samoans, coming alive now. So they found some friends in the audience.
What a laugh. Shoulder down. Oh, my word, look at there.
Fuji with a kick in the back.
Fuji caught Big Offa with a knee in the lower portion of the back, and that just brought the big Samoan immediately, instantly down to his knees. Dead weight there right now, and Fuji, Tiger Chung Lee, double teaming Offa. What is referee?
Well, he's not seeing it.
He's missing a pretty good match.
There are no tags anywhere to see, but they're taking advantage of his back toward them. We're talking now about Tiger Chung Lee and Mr. Fuji. So they're just at will going in and out of the ring. No sweat.
In the foreground, Big Sika watches as Mr. Fuji chops brother Offa. Tag Fuji to Tiger Chung Lee. Communications there off the ropes. What a total miss.
He rolled out and...
A total miss. Wait a minute. Oh, hold on a second. There was a... Fuji could not stand the fact that Tiger Chung Lee missed the mark. And he slapped Tiger Chung Lee across the face.
The bad blood here now, Gene.
Well, there's a shot to the ribs at barefoot of Tiger Chung Lee. Offa off the ring apron to come around the ring and check on the well-being of... I believe that is up. I'm starting
That's
to get
down
on... Right, Sika made the move.
Was trying to help him, and got to be careful. Watch for Fuji.
Oh, Fuji. Fuji kicks up. And Sika gets up on a ring apron. I couldn't believe earlier the exchange between Mr. Fuji and Tiger Chung Lee.
All right. Worley caught the end of that, and he saw Fuji coming after Offa.
Oh, look at there.
This is more of a Pier 6 brawl at this point in time, Gene.
Wait a minute. Somebody is getting upset. That may have been the straw that broke the proverbial camel's back. because we have got one hot Samoan on our hands this week in the form of Afa.
Well, these kicks by Tiger Chung Lee are having no effect, apparently, on Afa. And now he's on a tear. They're bringing him over towards Sika, and moving headbutt, and I'll tell you, the
there
tag is me.
Tag from Afa to Sika. And now this crowd starts to come to life. I don't believe Tiger Chung Lee can handle a lot more punishment like that as he begs for mercy.
Well, he begged for mercy, but he's not getting it.
Oh,
hands of Sika.
Right.
Sika's on a tear for sure.
Into the ropes. Here is the whip. Oh, shoulder. And that particular move takes Lee to the canvas, followed by a headbutt from high in the air.
Another
two.
Leg.
Kick out.
He didn't hook the leg, and it was unlikely that he could pin him at that point in time, nor did he.
Well, now with the man, the bulk of Tiger Chung Lee at 271 pounds, Lee most capable of being able to kick out if indeed he has the strength that apparently at that point in time he did. At this juncture, I couldn't be too sure.
Worley took the arm, the left arm of Tiger Chung Lee several times, lifted it to see if there was any movement there at all, any purposeful movement, and as he just has now. But Lee's hanging on. Still the pressure applied by Sika off outside the ring. Dick Worley watching the move, make sure no chokehold going on currently.
Capacity crowd this week watching on, along with yours truly, Gene Okerlund.
Lee grabbing for the face briefly, then let his hand fall.
And Dick Graham, I don't think anybody has really taken control thus far out of either one of these teams. Nobody has dominated for any extended period of time, at least.
Gene, this could go any way, and I think the fans know it, and that's why there's
look
a feeling
at that
of
shot.
Suspense.
Oh, my.
Talking about buying a used car from somebody. Ooh, no way. What a mean city. But I'll tell you, this could go either way, and the fans seem to know it. They're sort of watching expectantly. They don't know who's going to go.
Now there was a
nor do we.
Foot out of the rope just momentarily by Tiger Chung Lee.
And
Afa just kicks it right back in.
Sure.
But in the meantime, Sika and that face lock has taken its toll on a star from Korea.
Well,
a double teaming whip into the ropes. Oh, double clothesline.
Oh,
followed by a headbutt.
Worley,
we've got action.
Woo.
Mr. Fuji, reminiscent of December 7th, 1941, coming in from the blind side, both off at a referee's back turn. Tiger Chung Lee with a series of those martial arts combo moves.
Well, the tag made. Now Sika back in. Afa going to get a breather. Chung Lee taking the short end right now, getting a beating at the
Sika
hand.
Sika to the hair. All right. Tiger Chung Lee going down. Tag.
Seemed a reluctant tag by Mr. Fuji. I don't know. Maybe it's just my impression. They make contact now.
Now there's a couple of those double heart punches to the upper torso.
All right,
big Sika.
Tag made again. In off, out Sika.
Oh, headbutt.
Right to the breastbone.
Followed by a reverse knife edge by Wild Samoa number one. Mr. Fuji down at a knee. And now all of a sudden, I believe, Afa detected that foreign object again, and I think he was making a move for a body slam by Mr. Fuji as he just kind of stands over the large body of Afa, Samoa number one, snapmare takedown. And what has Mr. Fuji got in mind at this juncture?
Well, he's going up with
the stratosphere. He mounts the ropes. Could be the cry of Bonsai. Nobody home.
Everybody evacuated, and Fuji knows too well it was a bad move. The attention was good. The move started out okay. But Afa ducked it, and suddenly Fuji in trouble.
Fuji, I think, a little bit worse for wear on the bottom side. Oh, the reverse atomic drop.
Here's Fuji.
Got to pinch a little. Fuji, tag, Tiger Chung Lee. Fuji in bad shape right now. Tiger Chung Lee Toe to the sternum. Pick up, body slam. Tiger Chung Lee, now outside of the ropes, up on that second turnbuckle, mounts the top one, and he's going to try and make the move.
Oh, woo-hoo. He took it to him.
Oh, the headbutt between the shoulder blades.
Tag made, Sika in, off of up.
Samoans are on a roll, two count.
Close, but no cigar, no hooking of the leg. Headbutt, down goes Tiger Chung. No tag. He was reaching
what?
For a tag.
Hold on. Wait a minute.
Fuji hung him out to dry.
Dick Graham, let's hold the phone just a second. I do believe that Mr. Fuji turned his back on the tag.
He did, in fact.
Now he's asking for the tag. Tiger Chung Lee.
No.
Oh, he walked away from it. You've got to be kidding me.
I never saw it. Oh.
Never in my life.
He hung him out to dry.
But in the meantime, Sika totally dominating Tiger Chung Lee. And he just catapults him to the canvas. And now Mr. Fuji, ladies and gentlemen, has walked away from the ring.
He's going for an early shower, apparently.
He has walked away from the heat of the battle. Double headbutt.
Oh!
And again, while Samoans. Up
one,
Sika,
two, it's
three.
All over. And I'll tell you,
what a change of events during the course of this match. But Dick Graham, the real surprise to me, undoubtedly, has got to be the fact that on at least two occasions, Mr. Fuji walked away from a tag from his partner. Earlier on, Fuji became terribly frustrated with what was taking place to Tiger Chung Lee, and he actually slapped him across the face.
Well, for no apparent reason, Gene. I can't figure out why he hung him out the
door. This is teamwork, and obviously that was not the case. Let's get the official decision from our ring
announcer. Ladies and gentlemen, the winners of this contest, the team of Apa and Sika, the Wild Samoans.
All right, hold on. Here comes Mr. Fuji back to the ring. I'll tell you what, it's too late now. The best he's going to be able to do is muster an apology.
Oh, he's
Come on. Oh, hold on. Wait a minute.
He's
Mr. Fuji.
Him.
Fuji has taken the microphone cord and has wrapped it around the neck of Tiger Chung Lee. Well, there has been a blowout between these two allies.
What,
no
geez.
Longer so.
One
karate
question.
Chop.
Why? I can't understand it.
Outside of the ring right now, Tiger Chung Lee, as you can see, all wrapped up in a cord and a chair and a ring bell. And Mr. Fuji, I cannot believe Mr. Fuji. Oh. Don't tell me. Tiger Chung Lee is back on his feet, but out of nowhere, out of left field, appears the kendo stick, that very controversial piece of equipment that goes to the ring with this man every time he is introduced. And Mr. Fuji had better be concerned. Here comes Tiger Chung Lee, kendo stick in hand. And watch out, ladies and gentlemen, this could be it. A blowout has taken place between these two allies.
Oh!
Tiger Chung Lee missing. And he is hot. This friendship of quite some time has been thrown out this week here in the World Wrestling Federation between this man, Tiger Chung Lee, and his former tag team partner, Mr. Fuji.
But the funny thing about this, Gene, is suddenly the crowd has turned totally for the Samoans and Tiger Chung Lee, and totally against Mr. Fuji. Incredible. Unheard of.
Well, this is absolutely unheard of.
Woo-hoo! That sounds like a challenge to me.
That was indeed a challenge from Tiger Chung Lee, directed straight at Mr. Fuji.
Well,
what a matchup here in the World Wrestling Federation. Ladies and gentlemen, I can't believe it.
You talk about bad blood, we have it. And to ringside, Howard Eskin. Howard Eskin in evidence, checking things out. Well, fans, we're only moments away from the long-awaited confrontation between the Superfly and Rowdy Roddy Piper. Coming up next, only on Prism.
You heard of Piper's Pit. Welcome to Rudman's Rendezvous. This is really an honor for me to be able to do the interviewing of Rowdy Roddy Piper, the pride of Scotland, as we approach probably what will be one of the bloodiest matches ever seen here in Philadelphia at the Spectrum.
My blood.
That's what we want to talk about.
What do they call you, Killer Who? What do you call you, killer what?
Killer Cow.
You used to call that killer snooker. It didn't look too good down there with coconuts all over his head, bananas shoved up his nose, fresh fruit salad. Now, well, I'm sitting there beating him down, and now he's going to jump back into the ring with a concussion. The guy's not supposed to be in the ring right now. He's in the doctor's office. Just check it out right now. Go down there and see him. The doctor say to him, are you all right? The guy's still trying to do his ABCs. The problem is he's starting from Z. He's working backwards. Hasn't got a clue what he's doing. Going to come in here and fight Hot Rod. You see, the thing was that Jimmy Snuka is supposed to be a legend, right? Jimmy Snuka is supposed to be a legend, a professional wrestling. Everybody says, ooh, don't touch Jimmy Snuka. Ooh, don't touch Jimmy Snuka. Do you think for one second that I was going to come out myself, prime time, going to come out and let this geek that can't talk English, can't do nothing, man. All he's going to do is sit there. I says, I'll tell you what, Jimmy, here's the microphone. Go ahead and talk. Exactly the same thing happened, man. Absolutely nothing there. Hello? Not wrapped too tight, man. Nothing. Stand up. He allows me to have a coconut in my hand, and he bends over like after I've insulted him for 3 minutes, told him his women are fat, told him his mother or whatever I told him, man. Yeah, after that, 3 minutes, he puts the microphone down and he says to me, are you insulting me? No, just ribbing, Jimmy. Just ribbing, man. Are you kidding? And they say that I didn't deserve to hit him with a coconut. They expect me, it's like this, when they expect me, they say, well, why didn't you put the coconut down? Why didn't you put all the stuff down and just fight him like a man? You see, obviously, that's why you're sitting there and I'm standing here. Because I go into the philosophy that you don't hit a man when he's down, you kick him, it's much easier. We're not playing no games here. I feed my family from fighting. I will fight anybody, any place, anytime, bar. I don't give a damn, man. You just put some bucks down, I'll fight you, man, cameraman. I'll fight you. I don't care. I'll fight anybody, any place. So you want to fool around with Big Rod, man? This is the home of the Loch Ness Monster, brother.
Thank you very much, Rowdy Roddy Piper. But now we're going to see what really happens. We'll be right back.
Well, Gene Okerlund and yours truly, Dick Graham, ringside, and the excitement will not turn off. In the ring, well, there's the sign. There's the legend, Roddy Piper, manager wrestler extraordinaire. Might be disputed by thousands of other fans here at this time. Woo! I'll tell you, you talk about madness, Hulkamania a little while ago, and now here comes the Superfly. Let's listen.
For one fall with a 1 hour time limit. Introducing first from Glasgow, Scotland, weighing 233 pounds.
Look out, here we go.
Watch out, Mel Phillips. Referee Red Bastinis called for the bell. And look at this shootout.
It's all over. They're underway.
How?
Flying headbutt by Snuka.
Oh, my. Piper begging for mercy.
The fans are on their feet. Headbutt again. And outside the ring is Piper. Snuka going after him.
Of our very eyes. Not more than four. Five. Oh, come on.
Snuka took Piper right into our table here at ringside. And now Piper in the ring crying for mercy against Jim. Jimmy Superfly Snuka.
Well, a Superfly is going to show no mercy to this man. Oh, he's hanging on to his hair.
Woo! Oh, Snuka doing his thing as only he can.
Oh, no.
He's literally pulling Piper into the ring.
Snuka has certainly electrified this capacity crowd on hand this week in the World Wrestling Federation. And Piper is trying to back off. Whip into the ropes. Oh, miss.
Oh!
A collision that time that Piper staggers Piper and rocks Snuka.
Piper not in very good shape himself right now. Although, Snuka seemingly in trouble. He's on a tear.
In front of an international television audience.
Woo!
In Piper's pit. Snuka, humiliated, embarrassed, and absolutely pulverized by Piper. And it may be payback time in this one fall bout.
Well, there's no love lost between these two gentlemen, and the fans know it. And Snuka comes in with a huge crowd of fans on his side, of course.
Now look at this rowdy, rowdy Piper come to life. I thought he had taken a real shellacking here in the opening minutes of this particular one-fall bout.
Well, he takes Snuka right into the ring turnbuckle.
But I wonder if it had any effect, Dick Gray.
Seemingly not, Gene. Seemingly not.
Oh, big right to the midsection, a block. Oh, and a shot to the forehead. Snuka with a reverse knife edge to the upper torso. Into the rope.
Oh!
Fine. Body block. Both men over the ropes out of the ring apron onto the ring of the
floor.
You
talk about crazy. Both these men right outside the ring. But Piper apparently didn't get the full weight of it.
Oh! He just slammed the head of Jimmy Superfly Snuka into the steps that lead up to the ring. Snuka has got to be hurt.
There are a couple of faces we recognize at ringside, checking on the condition of Jimmy Superfly Snuka. Piper biting him, is it? Seems to be mauling him around the face. Snuka dazed, hang on by a thread. Fans cheering for him to get it on, get it together, Jimmy, please. And Piper trying to get him back inside the ring because he knows Snuka is on shaky ground.
By the way, I should point out Dick Graham, third man in the ring, one of wrestling's all-time greats, Red Bastine, as Rowdy Roddy Piper delivers and executes on knee lift to perfection on Jimmy Superfly Snuka.
Look,
oh, what a kick up.
But the sheer strength of Snuka picking up the body of Piper, shoving him toward the ring corner.
Another block. And a Superfly. It's home. Look at those rights. And another block. This time a block at a part of Piper. Pick up.
Oh, man. All right, the ring of the bell.
And look at the referee has called a match at Piper.
Bastine
is not going to let up.
Bastine trying to separate them.
Well, Bastine can if he so desires.
Oh, no. Piper hit Bastine.
Have you ever? Red Bastine is out. He just caught a haymaker.
His head.
Roddy Roddy Piper.
Bastine, the referee's head, hit every rope on the way down.
Well, hold on here. Piper paying no heed to the reprimand. A referee, Red Bastine. He's going to be subject to fine just by virtue of the fact that they hit the referee, but watch out. The Superfly has come to life. Piper's going to get his hat. Piper is going to run to the locker room.
Well, the fans are not surprised that Piper cut and ran, because they expect that from him, but they don't like it. They don't like it. Listen.
Oh, not at all. Not at all. We got to get the official decision off.
If they can find the microphone, I'm sure it's there somewhere.
Well, it's been all over.
I'll tell you, what an event tonight.
Let's get the official rendering.
Ladies and gentlemen, the referee has disqualified Rowdy Roddy Piper and awards this contest to Jimmy Superfly Snuka.
Well, by virtue of the disqualification of Rowdy Roddy Piper, there you see your winner getting the Duke, Jimmy Superfly Snuka, continuing his winning ways. Let's take a look.
All right, some of the action
earlier on here, Dick.
All right, going into the ropes now. Here it is, taking Snuka right to the ropes. The rope between his legs. Oh, mercy. Crashes to the canvas.
What a shot by our cameraman. I've got to compliment him. Absolutely superb.
Our director, Frank, even said he's going to be carrying a whip tonight. Huh? What action he's getting from our guys. Well, Superfly going off. The fans not too pleased at the turn of events, but there it is. And look, coming up. Dick Graham here with Gene Oakland, and we'll be back with more wrestling excitement after this. All right, this is Dick Graham at ringside, Gene Oakland with us, and getting ready now for the next event. And you know who, things are kind of calm here right now with the fans, but any moment now it should erupt because we'll be witnessing the return of the Animal. Need I say more? The young fellow by the name of Steve Lombardi is getting his lumps sort of the hard way.
We just saw him heading out of the locker room, down the chute, into the arena. And what kind of a reception?
Well, they
will
never...
George, the Animal still receive here this week. Oh. A lost soul.
Nobody's neutral when it comes to George the Animal Steel.
Duck! Who?
Did he look at you, Gene?
I don't know.
I like you, Gene, but I hope he was looking at you, not me.
Let's get the official introductions.
Wrestling fans, the following attraction is scheduled for one fall with a 30-minute time limit. Introducing first, from Detroit, Michigan, his weight 288 pounds, the Animal, George Steele. Ladies and gentlemen, from Brooklyn, New York, weighing 235 pounds, Steve Lombardi.
Well, Gene, I think the Animal has more sympathetic fans here than old Steve Lombardi.
All right, this man, George the Animal Steele, this week to do battle with the native of Brooklyn, New York, Steve Lombardi. Capacity crowd on hand, and obviously a foreign object in the mouth of George the Animal Steele, 288 pounds from Detroit, Michigan. Boy, he's just a master at concealing that foreign object.
Well, he just exposed the green colored tongue to the fans a moment ago, and that's always a delight. Lombardi's in for a real lesson and a real trip tonight because of the unpredictability of this man.
All right, a very unorthodox George the Animal Steele this week, the Tango.
Ooh.
With Steve Lombardi. Lombardi is gonna hold his own. And I believe that Steele is a little miffed. He knows who his opponent is, but I don't know how much above and beyond that he is able to ascertain.
He doesn't comprehend a great deal from what we've seen. He just knows hurt, injured, fall.
Lombardi, very much aware of the tactics of George Steele. And there you see
the foreign object in the right hand of the Animal.
That is quite obvious. Oh, right headlock, and there that foreign object came into play.
And Dick Morley really going after him. He wants that foreign object.
But what a shot Lombardi took. I am amazed that Lombardi could even get up.
Well, Whirly literally climbed up the body of the animal.
Look at that. Oh, back of the neck. And down.
Here's another turnbuckle pad.
Oh, look at that. That green tongue and that ominous expression on the face of that package they call the animal. George Steele here this week. Absolutely making mincemeat out of Steve Lombardi in this World Wrestling Federation event.
Well, Lombardi, a youngster to the wrestling wars, and he is matched up against a devastating wrestler in George the Animal.
We're going to need a housekeeper here, Dick Graham. Look at this. Oh, the contents of that turnbuckle that Steele has torn apart now just slammed into the face of Steve Lombardi, and there goes another turnbuckle. Oh, my. This man is incredible.
Well, the fans in that corner where he is now, they're liking it. They're digging it. They're saying, George, baby, go, go, go. But Steve Lombardi can't say the same. He's a gamer.
And again, the contents of that turnbuckle being pushed into the face of Steve Lombardi.
Interestingly enough, Gene, Whirly is trying to talk periodically to the animal, but of course we know that he doesn't hear or understand.
He's having a devil of a time communicating with George Steele. Oh, up over the top rope, out of the ring apron, down out of that hard arena floor.
And not only that, he took the side, the edge of the ring, right along the back, the other on his hip, I'm not sure.
Lombardi will never come back.
Well, the Steele
follows him outside of the ring. No!
Oh!
Come on!
The animal,
Now something.
He's biting on the top rope, for heaven's sake.
Something has really got George the Animal Steele upset. Well, that doesn't do Steve Lombardi a lot of good. Lombardi's still outside of the ring. We have not, from our vantage point, seen any movement over on that far side of the ring either.
We'll have to depend on our ringside camera to check out the body, so to speak, of Steve Lombardi.
Well, finally, the appearance of Mr. Lombardi. Referee continuing the count. How Lombardi came back with that is beyond me. Remember, no padding on that top turnbuckle. And that's got to tear away at the flesh of the upper torso.
And the animal kicking at Steve Lombardi, who's already down. No old fart here. Animal knows nothing about rules. Take him into the turnbuckle.
Not again, no!
Oh, got the shoulder, Gene.
Well, that's going to just tear Lombardi apart. That is going to tear them all apart. Look at that, ladies and gentlemen. One of the extraordinary wrestlers you'll see as part of the World Wrestling Federation, George the Animal Steele.
I think what he's doing is uncovering totally the metal clamp.
He certainly can't be thinking of lining up Lombardi. Yes, he is.
Digging there again.
Oh, why do I anticipate? That was even a bad thought. Premature though it was on my part. Lombardi, I'm certain, is going to be unable to continue.
Well, Lombardi really is down, but I don't know if this is going to make any difference to the animal, because he knows nothing about him.
No
compassion.
Well, here's a man that we're not certain can even think straight. You talk about somebody putting a sentence together. This man can barely put one word at a time together, and those are few and far between.
Well, the animal is doing as predicted. The fans just seemingly just cannot.
Oh, no. There is that
wide
hammer, and that's all she wrote. Lombardi could not.
All she wrote, indeed. That's it.
Contend with the tremendous pain that was dished out by this man, George the Animal Steele, getting the Duke by submission over Steve Lombardi. And there's, well, a somewhat surprised look at a part of a fan. Let's go back. And actually, this is more action. Come on, ref, get on his case. Reverse the decision for once. You can see the foreign object there.
I don't know.
Oh, no.
Oh,
come on. This has got to come to an abrupt halt.
Dick Worley smashed across the ring and out, down and out.
Worley is out of it.
I think
Worley is totally out of it. George the Animal Steel.
Oh!
No!
No! He's strangling Bill.
He's going for
he's
the ring.
He's crazy.
This is totally out of line. My God.
He's totally went crazy.
That man is not playing with a full deck. Referee, if you don't reverse the decision, it finds out leveled here in the World Wrestling Federation, I would be surprised. Let's go back in time and see how George the Animal Steel put it away over Steve Lombardi. Let's roll it and take a look.
All right.
This is what we call the Flying Hammerlock, patented by George the Animal Steel, as seen here in the World Wrestling Federation. What do you think, Dick?
I'll tell you, I don't know what to think, because we've seen the Animal at his worst time after time after time, and he seems to surpass even our wildest expectations. He is indeed George the Animal Steel. What an animal, and then some. Well, there he is, exulting in his mauling of young Steve Lombardi, and that's just about, that's all he did was hammer away at him, maul him, scratch at him, beat on him.
You know, Dick Graham, I've spent a lot of time at this great facility, the Spectrum, and I'll tell you, these wrestling fans here in Philadelphia, I've got to tip my hat to them. They are appreciative, they are astute, and very knowledgeable.
They are that, and they're good fans. And we'll talk more about these fans as we go. Dick Graham here with Gene Okerlund, and we'll be back with more wrestling excitement after this.
Ladies and gentlemen, here are some of the stars who will appear on this World Wrestling Federation card. The gold medalist, probably one of the strongest men in the world, the Olympian, Ken Patera. Also, ladies and gentlemen, making their very first debut at the Philadelphia Spectrum in a special six-man tag team attraction will be the Fabulous Freebirds. In addition to that, these bouts have been signed for Saturday, August 4th. Bob Backlund will face Salvatore Bellomo. And in a special one-on-one confrontation, the first Cobra Corps inductee, Terry Daniels, will face another outstanding wrestler also making his debut here at the Spectrum, the Ugandan giant, Kamala. Also, wrestling fans, a special midget match will take place. On the one side, the Haiti Kid, his opponent, Danny Carpenter. And also scheduled for Saturday, August 1st, Jesse the Body Ventura matches wits against the sensational Rocky Johnson. Ladies and gentlemen, in a special grudge contest, the samurai warrior, Mr. Fuji, signs to face Tiger Chung Lee. And then, wrestling fans, in a special Intercontinental Heavyweight title contest, the current champion, Tito Santana, faces the Iron Sheik. Ladies and gentlemen, to ensure that there will be order in this contest, a special guest referee has been signed. And that person is none other than gentlemen, the special guest referee in the Tito Santana Iron Sheik contest. No, it can't be. Gentlemen, the special guest referee, the Ayatollah Blassie. Ladies and gentlemen, the feature match, Saturday, August 1st, will see the master of the figure four leg lock, Greg the Hammer Valentine, as he will face the World Wrestling Federation heavyweight champion, the Incredible Hulk Hogan. Ladies and gentlemen, in addition to that great all-star card of World Wrestling Federation action, there has been signed a bonus contest. And in this match, here in this ring, Saturday, August the 4th, Big John Studd faces Andre the Giant.
Well, I'll tell you, some kind of a card, and for the record, it is going to be August the 4th, a Saturday night, back here at the Spectrum. Dick Graham.
Well, I'll tell you, Gene, if that doesn't bring wrestling fans in greater numbers than we have already experienced.
Well, you can't get too many more in here.
Not very many more, and I'll tell you, they'll be getting their tickets early, I know. Well, the big windup. Getting ready for the tag team matchup. We'll be getting the announcement in just a moment. This ought to be a happening also. We haven't seen Murdoch here in a while.
Well, I've followed Murdoch and Adonis around the World Wrestling Federation. And as of late, I must say, they are building up nothing but momentum. They are getting better with every outing.
Well, Adonis is not a stranger. We've seen him on numerous occasions, not lately for maybe a year or so. But we're glad to see him back because he comes to do it.
Wow.
Not shy at all.
Mm.
Woo. Someone we know or should know? Could you take her home to mama?
Speak for yourself, Mr. Graham.
My wife is not that understanding.
Well, we've got action coming up here. It is a title bout. Let's get the introductions from our ring announcer, Mel Phillips.
Wrestling fans, the following attraction is a special tag team event scheduled for one fall with a 1-hour time limit, and it is for the World World Tag Team Championship title. Introducing first the challengers from Tampa, Florida, weighing 232 pounds, B. Brian Blair. His tag team partner from Princeton, Minnesota, weighing 235 pounds, Bob Backlund. Ladies and gentlemen, they will face the current world tag team champions. First, from Waxahachie, Texas, weighing 275 pounds. New York, weighing 251 pounds, Adrian Adonis.
All right, the matchups are plain and simple. All gentlemen, we're very well aware of their talents and the matchups. It's going to be a tough night for all four. I don't know who will prevail, but Backlund, and you have Brian Blair, very sleek. The scientific type, if you want. The other two gentlemen, sort of the brawlers. Adrian Adonis, especially known for that. But nevertheless, each man respects the other.
You don't argue with success, though, Dick Graham.
Absolutely.
And right now, it is Adonis and Murdoch who are in the possession of those World Wrestling Federation Tag Team Championship belts. Well, a crowd now starting to get on the case of Adrian Adonis this week. Sound of the bell, and away we go. Dick Murdoch.
Brian Blair, his adversary. And that's exactly the term to use. Definitely a height advantage for Murdoch, and also a weight advantage if there is one. Brian Blair can hold his own.
Murdoch at 275 and Blair at 234. That was a nice gesture on the part of Bob Backlund. Collared elbow hookup. Blair trying to get down low, keep those legs apart, and he drives Murdoch back into the turnbuckles.
Well, a clean break. Brian Blair backs off, and so far, so good.
I have been impressed with B. Brian Blair, both of the single individual matches he's had here in the World Wrestling Federation, but especially in tag team bouts. The man has a tremendous knack to be able to communicate with his partner, and that, of course, is the name of the game in tag team competition.
Well, we know basically that the former champion, Bob Backlund, has wrestled as a single so very often, but then again has the capability, being flexible, of wrestling with another, in this case, Brian Blair.
Oh, we got action. Oh,
nice arm drag.
Beautifully executed.
Backlund, not too thrilled with something, made a move as if going into the ring.
Right on, B. Brian Blair working on that left arm of Dick Murdoch. Murdoch showed us a move or two. Comes up with a couple of consecutive elbows to the top of the head of B. Brian Blair. In the shoulder takedown. Talk about action. Beautiful hip lock. This B. Brian Blair, and I told you, Dick Graham, you were going to be impressed. He is a real spark plug. Arm drag. Look at that.
Well, we've seen Brian Blair in this arena on only two other occasions, I believe, and he does impress. He's a man very well set up, exercises regularly, works out, keeps himself in shape, and more important than anything, does know how to wrestle.
Attended the University of Louisville, all-around athlete, is from Tampa, Florida. Dick Murdoch exercising roughhouse tactics, and if you want to play rough, probably playing with the wrong guy downstairs.
Well, Adrian Adonis gets the tag. He comes in. Nice arm drag takedown. And boy, I'm telling you, Brian Blair's handing Adonis all he needs right now.
And this arena is buzzing this week as tag team action is in progress between B. Brian Blair, Bob Backlund on one side, beating the duel of Dick Murdoch, Adrian Adonis, current World Wrestling Federation Tag Team Champions. Good shot of the native of New York, forearm to the chops. And now into the ropes. Shoulder. Down goes Blair. Again, it on us off the ropes. Flying high. Jump over by Blair.
Oh! Monkey flip. Timing. Beautiful.
Followed by an arm drag.
Woo!
Oh, talk about your action.
Blair
again. Oh, mercy. A one-man game.
Oh! He came into the wrong side of the ropes.
Oh, no.
Backward.
Oh.
Adrian Adonis made a big mistake.
And he's going to get a powder or take a powder. Backlund comes after him. Goes him underneath the rope. Back into the ring. To face the music of Brian Blair.
He tried for a tag with Murdoch. Missed. So Murdoch can't help him right now. All right. Backlund making a fist, shaking his arm to his partner, saying, good going. Hang in there. You're doing fine. Backlund as yet has not made an appearance in the ring. Well, sort of, but yet not. But officially he's not been in the ring.
Boy, this Blair can turn it on. Great shot. Blair working on the left arm and moves up with the shoulder periodically on Adrian Adonis, 254 pounds, New York City.
Well, Blair just a few minutes ago was taking on both these gentlemen.
But now Adonis has got the...
the knee pad of Brian Blair.
I couldn't believe that.
Yeah.
Now, Blair didn't take that for long. Something has got to give. A couple of times over on the arm bar with a wrist, and something has got to give. Forearm to the chops.
Oh!
Shoulder
block.
He blew.
Oh! Took the elbow right on the neck, right on the throat.
Well, initially, though, he blew Murdoch away. Murdoch misses with an elbow drop. Blair picking Murdoch up.
Woo!
Body slam with authority. Dick Graham, you are seeing some kind of tag team action.
This is a half now. Bob Backlund in against Murdoch. A double body slam.
First Blair, then Backlund. And Adonis and Murdoch got a receiving end of some... good punishment. Oh, a miss when he tried for the tag.
Well, he tried for the tag and went right over the top rope and crashed down. He's stunned. Well, Murdoch is on the short end now with Blair.
Fell flat on his face, Adonis did. And now, both men on their feet. There is hair right in front of the referee's eyes. Joey Marotta, third man in the ring, officiating this match this week. Here in the World Wrestling Federation. Well, totally illegal double teaming tactics on the part of Murdoch and Adonis to beat Brian Blair, and they continue to do so.
Well, Backlund, of course, going crazy because no tag, and he does follow the rules wherever he can. But right now it's Blair in with Adonis, and Blair stunned into the ring turnbuckle. Oh! Backed out very quickly.
There's
the tag made.
And here, ladies and gentlemen, comes Bob Backlund. Native of Princeton, Minnesota, held the World Wrestling Federation heavyweight title 5 years plus and all. Adonis just about flew out of the ring and did a complete somersault.
Well, Adonis facing Backlund for the first time tonight. I'll tell you, man. Now Backlund
inviting Murdoch in, and Murdoch,
he wants a hunk of Backlund, but Backlund wants all of him. But
there's a little dialogue being exchanged between Backlund and Murdoch.
Well,
and I don't know if it bears repeating, but perhaps it couldn't be repeated anyway.
You're very right. But dirty looks could kill. Why Backlund wouldn't be here right now, but nevertheless, it takes more than that. A series of elbow smashes on Backlund by Murdoch. He's taking it to the former champion. Oh! He laid an elbow, forearm and elbow on Murdoch, drove him right across the ring.
Boy, he brought that one up from his bootlaces.
Tag!
There's the tag. Oh, Murdoch is checking the inventory in the tooth department. I believe he's minus a tooth or two.
He is that, and Brian Blair giving a lick and a shot to Adonis on the other side of the ring.
But I told you were going to be impressed with one of the bright, rising young stars on the horizon in a World Wrestling Federation, Dick Graham. That's what I said at the outset about Brian Blair, and I think you're going to have to agree he's everything I said he was.
No quarrel. He's probably more than you said. Blair has it all. He's got the moves, the strength, the vitality.
And he better have a little resiliency, because he has taken a pretty good shellacking right now at the hands of Richard Murdoch. Double teaming again. No, no.
Oh.
Double Backlund. Elbows.
Well, Backlund started into the ring. He's worn off by referee Varela. And now
again to the trunks. Back in that corner. Oh, look at this. Adonis. First to left. Then a right. And now the referee gets Adonis turned around. And there's that tag rope coming into play. Right across the windpipe of Bryant Blair. Oh, no.
What were they going to do with him? Adonis was going to pull him by the ankles. And, of course, the rope was around the neck of Bryant Blair. Now, Varela between both Backlund and Adonis. He ought to be twins, well, Varela. He's got a bunch of bad guys to handle here.
Well, he's got his hands full with the likes of Adonis and Murdoch. They're roughhousers, and I'll tell you what, they can just tear a referee apart. And I've seen the best in professional wrestling go down at the hands of Murdoch and Adonis.
You're right about that, Gene. And Backlund still outside the ring. Adonis on the other side, and it's Murdoch applying pressure to the arm and shoulder of Bryant Blair.
You know, Adonis and Murdoch can be terribly intimidating for a referee. Good, bad, or indifferent, they can really blow them away in a hurry.
Well, there's the tag. Adonis will be coming back in again.
Oh,
but meanwhile,
nicely done.
Nice takedown by Bryant Blair.
Well, there's the block, though, as you saw Dick Murdoch blocking Blair from a potential tag to his partner Bob Backlund. And certainly giving Adrian Adonis ample time to get in and pick up where Murdoch left off. He stepped over on that wrist a couple of times, and something has got to give, Dick.
Well, Adonis has that wrist lock on Bryant Blair right now. He's almost on his toes with pain, trying to get to rise above it.
Oh, look at this. Body slam.
He's going to try to get to Bob Backlund, and no way. But, of course, Morella's got to kick Murdoch outside the ring. There was no tag made there. Backlund going crazy, just dying to get in there.
Look at Murdoch, going to work on Blair. B. Bryan has done all he can for one man, but it's been basically a two-on-one situation as of late in the going here.
Well, Murdoch has the weight advantage right now, trying to hold Blair from making a tag at Backlund. It's about 2 feet separating the two when they outstretch their arms. And Murdoch still maintaining control here.
You know, Blair has got to be in fantastic shape, fantastic condition to withstand everything that he's taken thus far. Hip lock takedown. And again, look at that.
Adrian Adonis in the ring, and wasn't even a tag. He just came in. And totally one-sided. The fans are really getting really upset about this, as we are here at ringside.
Side headlock, Adonis to Blair.
Go take him into the ring.
Oh, what a last-minute ditch effort on the part of B. Bryant Blair, and he doesn't even know where his partner is. Oh, no.
Now
here
Backlund.
We go. Backlund with an explosion. Applause. Irish whip into the turnbuckles. Here's the sleeper
hold.
Good night, Irene. But Backlund makes it to the ropes and thwarts that effort on the part of Adrian Adonis.
Well, the only thing we can hope for now at this point in time, the chicken wing.
That's it.
This should be it.
Tag. No, there was a tag. Officially.
No. Smash down on the back of the neck. Backlund down now. The hands of Murdoch. Adrian Adonis outside the ring. Pounding taken by Bob Backlund. Rolling outside the ring and down. Woo! Murdoch right on top.
Oh, they've torn a... Some of the material off the ring.
Now Bryant Blair going to the assistance of Bob Backlund. And Murdoch inside the ring. Adonis outside. Well, eventually they're going to start counting. Bryant Blair saying, hey, the guy's hurt. What are you talking?
Now Backlund is hurt. He is on his knees. He has not been able to recover at all.
The fans yelling for Backlund. Come on, get it on, get in.
No, Adonis. Adding insult to injury. Bob Backlund on a ring apron between the first and second ropes. Dick Murdoch gets ready to tee it up. And he does. With a pretty good size roundhouse right. Murdoch bites Backlund. No, come on, Murdoch.
Well, he bought him, probably bit him with a tooth more than his teeth. Adonis kicking out at Backlund at this point.
And I'm surprised that Backlund didn't buy the farm. He took just an absolutely devastating blow outside of the ring.
And talking about outside the ring, he's outside again.
And you've got to remember now, Dick Graham, we're talking about a hard cement floor. This is like a rock. You land this thing from 8, 10, 12 feet up in the air. That's conceivable if you go off the top rope.
Well, Backlund struggling as the former champion that he is, struggling to get back in the ring, and is back now, although dazed, and Murdoch taking him to the ropes. Backlund
tries for the sunset flip, and he does the 1-2.
Almost. The tag made. Adonis back now. Uh-oh. He'll make a wish.
And there was a boot to the upper inner thigh. A pop
back. Adonis spit at Brian Blair.
But in the meantime, referee's back turned.
Oh! Backlund saw it coming and couldn't get out of the way.
That had to hit him in the throat just by the instinctive reaction of the man's body.
Well, Backlund's down and Adrian right on top of him.
Now Backlund makes it to the ropes. Oh, no!
Murdoch outside.
Give me a break, ref. Throw it out.
Now Murdoch has Brian Blair. Takes him into the
wrong
iron.
For God's sakes.
You talk about a brawl. This is it and a half.
I'll tell you, we could have just as well been in a back alley someplace.
Somewhere in a back alley. Adonis. Backlund doesn't even know that Brian Blair's not there to tag. He's trying to get over to that corner.
There is Trunks again at a part of Adrian Adonis. Goes for the pickup.
Oh! Takes him right down.
Now look at this. The Brian Blair, quite the cheerleader, because he's got this capacity crowd charged up. And there's the chant of Bobby. Bobby beating the one and only Bob Backlund.
Backlund.
Oh, Backlund is all over the place.
He's trying desperately
to fight the fact that two men are on him. A pickup.
Oh, Backlund reverses it.
Oh, no. He hurt his knee.
He did, I think. I don't know if he can crawl over there and make that tag or not. Oh, the place is coming apart. B. Brian Blair back in the ring now against Murdoch.
We're going to blow the roof off this place this week. Blair in. Right, left, back and forth. Whip into the
hole. Adonis is off the top of the rope.
Look at this, Blair.
Woo-hoo.
One man
game. Man. And now Adonis hung up on the ropes. There they smash together.
There's no way that Adonis could get out unless he gets some help. Hey, Brian Blair.
Murdoch is going around in circles.
All four men in the ring. Look at this. Shoulder into that ring post.
Well, if he can get up from this, I'll be surprised. But the double team.
Up, head over.
Woo!
Double back body drop.
Boom!
From Blair and Backlund. One, two.
And a kick out.
Oh, how close to see a new world tag team champion.
Almost did.
Into the ropes. Here it is.
All right.
Here it is. Abdominal stretch. Takedown. One, two.
Oh. Blair had to break the hold to get away from the elbow of Adonis.
Hey, do we have new champions?
I don't know.
But apparently not. Watch this maneuver.
Oh.
It is all over.
It really is.
Oh, my. It could.
If Brian Blair gets up from this in a while.
It would be a miracle.
Oh, that's it.
It could have been 300.
Oh, mercy.
Not a popular decision. Very controversial, as a matter of fact. Like him or not, they still remain tag team champions of the world. Adrian Adonis and Dick Murdoch. getting the Duke over Bob Backlund and B. Brian Blair. And again, I must emphasize, a very, very controversial decision.
Absolutely, Gene. I'll tell you right now, Brian Blair's in bad shape, favoring his head. He took a terrible pounding coming off that top rope at the hands of Murdoch and Adonis.
All right, tremendous crowd, and I'll tell you, Dick Graham, it has certainly been a pleasure for me to join you here at the Spectrum, as only seen on Prism. It has been an exciting evening, to say the least.
Well, we've benefited from your expertise, Gene. We've had a pleasure being with you. And a big card, August the 4th. All we can say is thank you, Gene, and good night, and be with us on the 4th.